In this video lecture, we'd like to start talking about the basics of what a string looks like and how we'd go about creating one. Okay, let's get started. Our first two Java classes have been CS12Date and String. CS12Date is a Java class that I made up for teaching purposes, and we've gone over it in the prior video lectures and some example source code. String, on the other hand, is an official part of the Java programming language. Regardless of the origin of any Java class, a full description of it is given in its API. In particular, for the String class, its API tells how to create objects of that class type using its constructors, and how to manipulate string objects using its available methods. It's important to always keep in mind that the Java API is always the authoritative source for the API of any Java-provided class. We'll talk more about accessing the Java API online in a coming lecture. Once you can get to the Java API online, you'll have everything you need at your fingertips. For now, you'll find a summary version of the String API in this lecture and the ones which follow. As always, to use any Java class, first we need to be able to create objects of that class, and that of course is a job for its constructors. Here are two representative constructor forms for the String class. We can create a new string object by simply providing the literal text value we want it to have. For example, here we are creating a string object called greeting, and we are instantiating it as usual by using the new keyword, a string constructor, and the text value we want our string object to have, hello in this case. Or we can use the default constructor, which needs no input arguments, and as shown here, we're creating a string object called empty, having no text. The String class is notable in that it provides a special shortcut way of instantiating new string objects without using the new keyword or a constructor, as we see here. We can simply declare a string object and set its value equal to whatever text we desire, as seen here. This operation comes up so frequently that this special shortcut is warranted, and this is the only class we'll see in this course that allows this. As it turns out, this will probably be the typical way you'll want to create new string objects going forward. Now that we've seen how to create new string objects, what does a string really look like under the hood? How do we visualize it? Well, truthfully, I really don't know how string is implemented internally. Maybe it's an array, maybe it's a linked list, but really, we don't know and we don't care. All we do know is that it's some organized collection of single chars, because that's the only one of the 8 fundamental data types which handles textual information. You'll commonly see strings represented as shown here, as a zero-based group of indexed chars. You can think of there being an array of individual cells, each one containing one char, and each cell having a zero-based index value. When you declare a string, it results in a string reference that points to the actual data elsewhere in memory, just as we saw for any other object. After all, string is a class, and each individual instance is just a string object. So here, when we declare the string mystr, it results in only the string reference here. Then when we instantiate the string, using either the shortcut or formal way, we set aside enough room somewhere else in memory to hold all the required chars, and we associate that string reference with that region in memory. And so that's how we create strings and what they look like conceptually in memory. Is this exactly how they are implemented? We can't really be sure, but this model is accurate enough for us to be able to visualize strings. Next, let's start looking at what we can actually do once we have set up a string.